Welcome to New Game Plus. I'm Tim. I'm joined by Kirsty. How are you?
I'm very excited. We're kind of moving on with our new cosplay segment this week. So I'm starting to, you know, get those calluses on my fingers from all the pricking of the nails and stuff like that.
We have the mannequins laying around the studio. It's very very strange when you walk into a dark studio and you just see a silhouette there.
It's actually really funny because, of course, I usually have these set up at home, but I also have a six-foot inflatable Stig that stands next to the phone.
So but who wouldn't want to be greeted by a big inflatable Stig?
Well, that's it. So we've got the six-foot Stig at the front door, and then we've got a seven-foot-tall Bundy bear at our front door that scares people away.
And so, you can just introduce the tourists to, this is a drop bear, this is what happens.
Yeah, exactly. And it works so well. But yeah, speaking of oversized things, of course, our big review for this week.
Yes, Titanfall. Yes. Optus have finally got around to
somewhat
fixed their routing. So we've sort of played Titanfall, but thankfully, some of us at the studio are on Telstra, so they can actually play Titanfall to bring you the review. But moving on, we've also got a movie segment later on.
Yeah, we've got our guys have gone and seen a couple of the cool new movies that are coming out. So it's not only a busy time for video games, we're getting really cool time for a lot of big A-grade movies, which is really exciting.
Certainly is. And a lot of time for handhelds as well.
Yes!
So I've been playing my 3DS.
I know, and you've got your new one as well. I love it. I'm so excited to see it. But let's go into our first review.
Well, some things are timeless. They never age.
Yep.
Much like Baby Mario in Yoshi's New Island that we're going to be reviewing right now for the 3DS. So, Baby Mario has once again been dropped by that bloody stork that doesn't do its job.
Butterfingers just dropping things all over the place.
Butterbeak. And Yoshi ends up finishing the job and delivering him to the right parents.
Yes.
Yes. So, it is a 3DS title, one of the big flagship titles coming out this year.
Of course, the original was on the SNES and something that I was a huge fan of. And I've got my Yoshi shirt on, so
it's quite sexy.
Yes.
Anyway, back into the game. So, Yoshi's Island, I would say that it is quite faithful, apart from the aesthetic. I find the visuals, it goes for that chalky art style that the original had.
I like that though.
I really like that. So I reckon it hits the notes quite well in terms of imitation physically and visually.
But in terms of hitting notes.
In terms of hitting notes, yes, absolutely.
The music is certainly something that deviates from the original.
Yeah.
And there's certain things like when you go through the goal to at the end of the level, it's not as like chimey as it used to be.
The composition's there, but the music just doesn't hit the right notes. Like it's but it just doesn't have the oomph that the original had.
Yeah.
And given that the SNES had a much less powerful sound card, that's saying something.
Yeah, so it does set itself up in the same way as the old one did with all the different worlds and the different levels.
Same transformations.
Yep, similar levels. The difference, one of the big differences in this, they've got to force in some 3DS gimmicky gyro sensors.
Unfortunately, they don't give you the option to opt out of that and use normal controls, so I find that a bit frustrating, especially a lot of 3DS games are doing that now, giving you the choice.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, Yoshi's Island, it's that or nothing.
Yeah, but as far as the game goes itself, I really enjoyed the game. It is very similar in mechanics and all the boss fights work really well.
Level design is fantastic.
Yeah, just a great platformer with lots of little puzzles.
Little secrets, really good. The one issue I had with it, though, is the controls. Now, Yoshi's Island is a very precise game, having to throw eggs, be very precise.
Yep.
I know Trihex does speedruns of the original Yoshi's Island, and it's something to behold. But unfortunately, I don't seem to quite replicate that with the 3DS version. Not the game's fault, but because of the 3DS controls. It feels a little bit clunkier than the original one, but all in all, I still reckon it's pretty decent for kids.
Yeah, there's something to be said about the difficulty as well. It's not probably as hard as the SNES version, but it certainly is a good game.
Mileage may vary.
Just even seeing this game just brings back so many fond memories of playing this on the Super Nintendo. It was such a fantastic game for its age.
It was. And when you come to it, it's a new look at the game. It isn't the same game mode over again. So there is changes to it, but it does still have that great feel to it. And that's all that matters.
But apparently the music's different.
Yes, it is a bit different.
That hurts me because I love the original Yoshi's Island soundtrack.
As did I. But they did have some good music in there. It was hit and miss with some of the stuff. But I think if they just put in the same music and the same levels and the same everything, then it's not really doing anything. It's just re-releasing it for the 3DS.
But it is, isn't that...
That wouldn't be a bad thing.
It wouldn't be a bad thing, but I suppose perhaps they are trying to also adapt it maybe to to the game itself, yeah. like to the Game Boy, sorry. Because on the SNES, I mean, it works though, because it was episodic gameplay. Yeah. It was, you had those files, and then you had the levels. Yep. And so I guess I can see that it would translate really smoothly. And it was just, it was so cute. Like baby Mario and baby Luigi, and then they would cry. And then yeah. that really sad story at the end.
Yeah.
Remember the really, like where they came from? And I was yeah. like, oh, Yoshi.
Because I felt, and you get to the end of this one and yeah. it's like, oh, this many Yoshis sacrificed their lives to get baby Mario to their parents. I was like, oh, I just beat the game. It was real sad.
Oh my gosh, I don't think I can play this anymore.
Now, Cardi, Ground Zeroes or the most expensive demo ever, if you believe NeoGAF.
I was just going to say, and now for something completely polarizing.
Yeah. So, like, for us as Metal Gear Solid fans, perhaps we're coming into this with a little bit of bias and people will write on our Facebook walls about it, but I love the series.
Yes.
And I really enjoyed this.
Absolutely.
I think I need to get that out of the way first before we cover exactly what it is.
Yes, so Metal Gear Solid Ground Zeroes, or Metal Gear Solid 5, sorry, is a prologue to the Phantom Pain, yes. which will be released later on next year.
Maybe.
It is Kojima actually, we're talking
that
about.
That is very true. So it basically takes place in, I mean, they call it Camp X-Ray, but let's face it. No, Camp Omega.
Camp Omega.
But let's face it, it's Guantanamo Bay.
Yeah, like, of course.
The whole idea is they're pretty much taking on Guantanamo Bay. You have to sneak in and rescue Chico and Paz from Peace Walker. That's the basic premise of the story, if mm-hmm. you will. And you do the usual Metal Gear Solid stuff, but in the most refined version of Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, I mean, as far as a third-person shooter and the mechanics involved, as far as stealth goes, it's quite accommodating. Yeah. It's very well done. I mean, you can go in as gung-ho or as stealthy as you like.
And I think that he's managed to nail that balance. Like, it handles really well as a third-person shooter, if you're so inclined. But if you actually want to sneak around and try stuff, the CQC is as robust as it ever was, if not more so.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just everything about the game seems to be, he's finally nailing the formula. The themes, well, we can debate those all day, but I really think that what happens in the Ground Zero story, just, at one point, Max Payne was the most pitiful character in gaming. And now it's Big Boss.
Oh, Big Boss is finally starting to get fleshed out. This is the part within the series where he finally snaps.
Yes.
This is during Les Enfants Terribles, where Solid Snake and Liquid Snake are born from his DNA.
Yes.
So this is a very pivotal part in the Metal Gear Solid series, and Ground Zeroes nails the dark and moody themes quite well.
Yeah. And it just everything about it screams really great. But yes, it is short. If you're playing just a story, yes, it's short. However, there's plenty of side ops to go on. There's one great Easter egg involved in them.
We won't spoil it.
But for fans like us, I don't know. I feel that there was enough in it to justify the, and I will admit, ridiculous Australian price tag.
Mm-hmm.
However, I didn't pay the Australian price tag. So I don't feel completely bad on that. But I still think if you're a Metal Gear fan and you love the universe, this is like a welcome addition.
It is a case of you only get out what you put in. Yeah. So people complaining about the 2-hour limit, that's complete bullshit. Yeah. I've played about 14 hours worth, and I'm pretty sure you've played just as much.
Probably ignore, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. If you're going to go in and explore the nuances of Camp Omega, and there's plenty of detail there, you won't go hungry.
No. Well, the girls are doing the sewing part. They're doing the actual difficult part. I've decided that I'm going to come down and try and look as much like Bass as I can before we go into it. So I've enlisted my good friend Alyssa. Jewel Body Sculpting. And we're here at Next Level. And you're going to try and kick me into the next level, I believe, is how it works.
Absolutely. And don't take this the wrong way, but we've got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, that's fine. Look, as I say, I knew what I was signing up for when I picked you to help on this, so I'm not afraid. Let's do it. Let's get into it.
Okay.
Oh God. Hey. Macho, macho man. Macho
man, yeah. I've got to be a macho man. I've got to be a macho. So for the look that Jason's going for, we really need to widen his back. And to do that, we have to be able to get his traps out of it. So as well as back, we're focusing on shoulders. And then as we progress, we'll start going to arms as well. So yeah, we're just working major muscle groups to make sure that we're getting the best bang for our buck. So until we get closer to where he needs to get into costume, we're gonna just hit him as hard as possible with the heavy lifts.
Body.
That sounds our first step into becoming the strongest man in the universe. Like, I'm literally struggling to hold up the mic as it stands, so I guess you've done your job?
I think so, yeah.
What do you reckon? You reckon in 6 weeks' time we'll see something remarkable?
You will see dramatic change in 6 weeks, yeah, definitely.
So it's back to the diet, which is good because I'm not starving. And then I guess I'll see you in 2 weeks' time for more masochism.
Yeah, I've got a leg day planned, so that's going to be...
Fuck. All right, see you then. Bye.
So I am back with Danny for week two of New Cosplay Plus, which is very exciting. Mm-hmm. And this week we went material shopping. Yay. So tell me, Danny, what did we kind of do to pick our materials?
Yeah, well, we looked at the characters in the game. Mm-hmm. And then we thought about what kind of fabrics we could use to recreate that.
Mm. So which character are you doing again?
I'm going as Sarah Bryant.
Cool. So you've got the blue jumpsuit version.
That's right. Yep.
I'm doing the Mariposa and her Lucha Libre costume.
Yep.
And Buff Jason is doing Bass Armstrong and his Lucha Libre costume. So obviously the one thing we did need...
It's spandex.
Which That's was right. actually harder to buy
I know.
Than we thought, which Who is knows? Weird. But I think our favourite piece of fabric we purchased was this.
Yeah, I'm a big fan.
So talk me through this, Danny.
Okay, so this is a faux leatherette, and we bought it because we're going to make it Bass's cape. It's got a lot of weight to it. It's got a slight sheen, and more importantly, we don't have to double up on lining, and it's going to look great and recreate the gameplay.
And I just love the feel of it. So it'll look nice. Classy without looking tacky. And I think that's something that's sometimes hard to do when you are trying to do an over-the-top Lucha Libre
that's
costume.
Right.
We also picked matching fabrics for the gold, so that's actually also a faux leatherette. Mm. Again, because it's going to be, you know, part of the accents of it, and also in some of the black material, you want it to match because
that's right.
You can't be sewing satin to crush velvet.
No,
it's just really hard.
Doesn't happen.
And then of course the
We've
favorite
got into detail, yeah.
Very blue nice. And our nice gold. So that was the material side, which worked quite nicely. Of course, the next part you need are patterns.
That's right.
And I think the big thing is, do you make the patterns yourself?
Look, unless you're an experienced seamstress or you know how, I say just go for a pattern.
And just piece them together.
Yeah,
I
easy.
Mean, I even bought a sleepwear pattern because I need a vest. So most of these patterns within brands will piece together really easily.
Yeah.
If not, they'll piece together anyway. So again, practice makes perfect. And really, get a doll. These dolls, if you're doing something complicated, are worth their weight.
They're so helpful.
So obviously, all right, so next week, we of course are moving on to actually cutting everything out, which is so exciting. So we'll see you next week.
Now, last month, when we were here, we looked at the Raid 1.
So, in this episode, let's take a look at the sequel, the Raid 2.
Now, the Raid 2 is, I don't know, it's everything that you would hope a sequel to the Raid would be.
So, it's longer, well, I guess maybe that's not the thing you want, but it's more ambitious.
Yes.
It has more story.
Yes.
The fight scenes, I think, are longer.
I would say longer, and if not as good a quality, probably better. The only thing that, to be fair, he's obviously, you know, he's got a lot more money, this one, and they said, go nuts, do what you're going to do. And, you know, watching some of the background stuff, it was actually, you hear him saying, some of the complicated shots that they did could have been done with computer graphics and whatever, it could have been done easier. But they specifically went out of their way to do the more complicated shots. And sometimes it works. And sometimes, like, this.
I think for the very first shot, you can see the ambition in the film. The film follows on directly from the first one. I don't think you definitely need to see it.
You get the basic idea.
Yeah. But I mean, like, he's now going undercover in the mob. But yeah, it's a great film.
Yeah, it is. It's a worthy sequel to a surprise hit. Simple as that.
Yes. It still has those awesome, drawn out, incredibly violent and bloody fights.
Oh, yeah.
So if you like that sort of thing, you will really like it. If you get squeamish or don't like extreme violence,
maybe you should check out Captain America Winter Soldier.
Did you see? Oh, my God. That was... Whoa.
So Captain America Winter Soldier is Captain America.
It's a sequel. Yeah. It's in
it
the Marvel Universe.
No,
you know, it's following on from Avengers. Some stuff's happened. It's you can watch it as a standalone movie.
You can. You don't necessarily need to have seen the first one. You don't need to see the Avengers. I haven't seen the Avengers. I have seen the first Captain America movie, which was okay. This was surprising me. Like, okay, so keep in mind, I've just come from watching The Raid.
You watched it 5 seasons, you're like, this is pretty good, except I just saw The Raid 2 the other day, which was fucking awesome.
Yeah, and so it was still really good. Like, I really enjoyed it. For a derpy American comic book movie, the fights were good, the driving scenes were good. Like,
the story was good, you know, the whole thing with Captain America is obviously he's very much kind of like Superman, where he's a bit of the Boy Scout.
Yeah.
And what they've done is they've put him in a situation where it's like, can he trust the people he's taking orders from? Fury is really good in it. They introduced the Falcon, who's really good.
Yeah. It's hard to say anything but that it's a good movie. Now, I've said good a lot in this review, but it is. It's, you're going to enjoy it. It's great popcorn. I think they handled him dealing with his past very well, like in the sense that, you know, he closes a lot of gaps there that annoyed me in the first movie.
There's lots of little like tidbits for fans, you know, their name checks even Strange, which is one of the movies coming out in 2020 or something like that.
The next 14 that are coming out,
and of
tomorrow,
course there's stuff after the credits, but I think both films definitely worth watching.
Done well, Horadrim. Your service here is finished, and you should all run. Malfail.
Now, I love cardboard animations. I love them so much. I have one of their Zergling t-shirts, mm-hmm. and it's just the cutest thing ever. I love it. And Reaper of Souls, obviously, big release. It's just come out. We're playing it a lot, and we'll have a review for you
soon. Oh, because I was going to say, I was watching this, and I didn't know what to expect. And I was like, I've seen this trailer before.
Yeah.
Where? And then it didn't click until like the dude with the wings turned up at the end. I was like, it's the Diablo trailer.
Malfiel is a bit more scary in the game than he is in the trailer.
But they're just so cute. I love how they bump into each other, and it's really kawaii, I suppose. So, it's cutie.
Now,
Now, Don, Titanfall, EA's big release, comes out, it's fantastic, and yet another game plagued by online problems.
Not necessarily to EA's or Respawn Entertainment's fault. This has all been due in Australia anyway, due to the fault of Optus.
Yes, now Optus in the southeastern suburbs of Melbourne is munted, absolutely munted. They've only just started fixing most places, so our studio being located in the southeastern suburbs of Melbourne, I have not played a single game of Titanfall, yet I sit on this couch across from you as somebody who did play some of the beta.
Mm-hmm.
It's been out for a while as we film this.
Well, it feels like forever in the gaming space, in the first-person shooter space,
and
at the very least.
And particularly in Christmas to Electric Boogaloo, mm-hmm. because there's lots of games at the moment. Tell me about it. Like, try and convince me to get into it, because at this point, it's passed me by.
The best thing I could say about Titanfall is that it is Call of Duty done better. It is, of course, executive produced and led by the people who originally formed Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare, the definitive first-person shooter of the last generation.
Yeah,
and it feels very much like an evolution of Call of Duty. You would have seen it in the beta, and it's very much still present in the final version of this game as well. Just the gameplay is fluid, guns still feel fun, and auto-aim is negligible.
And the weapons seem unique, like you know, even things like the silly things like the smart pistol, but it's still got your core favorites there. People want to walk around with assault rifles and shoot Call of Duty style, it's still,
You still have bastards sniping from rooftops and things like that.
Yeah.
But the main thing that Titanfall has over Call of Duty is the momentum, the fact that you can double jump, the fact that you can wall run. Indeed, there aren't enough opportunities to do so. Matches eventually just devolve into everyone on ground, especially when the Titanfalls arrive, which is, of course, Titanfall's other main feature, the giant robots that dominate the battlefield after 3 minutes.
And this is the thing, like, I know from playing it, the Mirror's Edge style, like parkour and things like that, was great, but I found less opportunities to use it. Like, and the few people who do use it well, you will find more success if you do, simply because you have to stay alone. But the second they start clumping together at threes, charging through doors, it kind of devolves into COD. Like, let's be honest.
But a better COD, though, because unlike, say, Call of Duty Ghosts, you're not running around for what feels like forever.
Yeah,
doing absolutely
people.
Nothing, running into nobody. Even though maps are only 6v6 still, the fact that they're filled with bots and the fact that people can move around everywhere, you're still going to run into action every 30 seconds or say.
Plus, the robots don't feel unbalanced. At least they did in the beta. Like, yeah, they're scary because they're giant robots. But at no point do you feel like we're completely dead because a robot showed up.
With the right strategy, even a single pilot can take down a giant titan.
So the question is then, at this point, is it worth me coming into it? Like, am I going to meet too many prestige people? Am I going to meet too many people too far ahead of
me? At the moment, yes, because as of recording, matchmaking, I always found myself lumped up against 5 or 6 people who had gone on to the next generation, which is this version of the prestige.
Prestige, right.
But having said that, it does sort of feel like an evergreen. It feels like there will be life to it, unlike the other Call of Duty nominees out there. Mm. And indeed, we've seen that with Call of Duty just taking a Titanfall in its numbers. I apologize for that.
Did you really?
I am so sorry.
Well, I finally got on after Optus fixed some of this stuff, and I played a few games, and it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm on Tosha, so I didn't have any of these problems.
Yes.
But yes, now this is the interesting thing about this game is it's a multiplayer only game, and now of course, you know, we've always talked about the fear of an online only game launch because obviously it gets overly, which it did, but I don't know, a lot of the issues seem to have ironed out.
But considering these are the guys that originally did COD, they're from Infinity Ward, people only get that game for the multiplayer. So it makes sense that they go for a multiplayer-only game. And the campaign is worked in... it's different. It's something that someone hasn't done before. So I guess, like what they're trying.
And I guess it's good that they just didn't even bother with the single player. Like, it was like, we're not even going to devote any attention to this. And I think it really has helped the quality of the multiplayer as well, because they've just only been able to focus on the mechanics of that. And it's such a pretty game.
Yeah.
Like I said, visually, it really does blow me away. But speaking of blown away.
Yes. Oh, segue. we had our movie segment with Captain America 2 in this episode. So we've got some very marvelous prizes coming.
Oh, that was shocking. Yes, so we've got a bit of a competition for you where you can win t-shirt, notebooks. We've got this really big prize pack thanks to Marvel. And the idea is Captain America doesn't really have that much of a catchphrase. He's got Avengers Assemble, but we thought new movie, new Captain America, new catchphrase.
make something good. When's Marvel is not an acceptable answer.
No, that is not an acceptable answer. So feel free to enter. You know, it can be as many words as you want, but obviously shorter is better.
Yep, on our Facebook, contest at New Game Plus. Send us an email there.
Yep, you can obviously send it on Twitter as well or Instagram if you wish. So
Let's wrap it up. Visit our website, www.newgameplus.tv.
Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/newgameplustv.
Follow our Twitter and Instagram, @newgameplustv.
Thank you so much. And don't forget our Twitch TV, twitch.tv/newgameplustv. Plus, it's Supernova Weekend in Melbourne this weekend. Check it out. And we will see you next week.